Acceptable to God. You know, everything that we do in life has to be acceptable to God, being a Christian. That's what we strive for, being accepted and approved of by God. But tonight, I'd like to talk a little bit about something else that should be acceptable to God, and really, that's our worship. You know, we live in a country today that people think that, hey, anything that I can do for God and just do in the name of God, He'll accept. And I can do anything that I want and worship any way that I want as long as I say it's for God. People are really misunderstood or misunderstand the Word of God when they have that type of attitude toward how they worship God. In Hebrews 12, beginning with verse 25, it says, "See that you refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escaped not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, Yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this world, and this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore we receive a kingdom which cannot be moved. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear." What a lot of people forget is worshiping God in an acceptable way, in a reverent way, and with godly fear. They worship God in any way that they want because that's what they see other people doing. And they see that and think that it's okay. I read a survey the other day. It was done by a company who put out a book. And the name of that book was Directions for the Road Ahead. And in that survey, a lot of people wondered and were asking the question, as it talked about in the road ahead, asked the question, why are so many people worried and why are so many people focused on what everybody does in worship to God? This type of question in and of itself seemed to be saying that the worship of God ought not to demand as much attention as it does. If you ask that kind of question, what's all the fuss about? You know, the fuss all about is we should define our attention. We should make our worship acceptable to God. We should do the things that God wants us to do. We shouldn't just be able to do and throw in anything we want and call it acceptable to God. I think we have to realize that any attempt to create respect and reverence for God and to have any type of relationship with God without devotion to study, without devotion to worship, without trying to please God, give Him the grace and the honor that He deserves is in vain if we do anything and don't do that. From the very earliest recordings of man's history in the second generation, from Adam's sons, we see Cain and Abel. And through subsequent generations, man has been a worshiper. Man has always worshiped something. They've not always worshiped God, but they've always worshiped something. God has always showed a deep interest, though, in what man did. He's been very displeased with man when they show a very deep interest in worshiping idols or other gods, and He showed His pleasure with men and mankind when they are faithful and worship Him in a right way. Because God is deeply involved, worship is a very sacred thing. We worship God because God created everything. We wouldn't be here if it weren't for God. And for us to minimize our worship to God and say, well, it's not really all that important, anything that I can do should be acceptable to God, is to make light and to trivialize God. God is the greatest being that ever was and ever will be. When we offer our worship to God, it has to be something special. From our Bible reading this evening, it says that we're to worship God in spirit and in truth. So God never intended us to worship any way that we wanted to, and to throw in anything that we want to. In the case of Cain and Abel, what was unacceptable with Cain's offering was Cain had not the respect for the blood sacrificed to the Lord. He substituted an offering of grain from his fields. Think about this for a moment. Is it possible that Cain was like many people today in substituting what he wanted to give as an offering to God, how he wanted to worship God? There's many people that are like Cain today. They substitute and worship God in the very way that they want rather than in the way that God wants. Many people say, well, it really doesn't matter, you know. It really doesn't make that much difference how we worship God. Yeah, it does. It makes a lot of difference how we worship God. Simply said, as many think today, you can worship any way you want, has no place in the way we worship God. God wants to be worshiped the way that He wants to be worshiped, not the way that anyone else desires and wants to worship. Abel offered a blood sacrifice, and that's what God had instructed, and God was pleased. Hey, God had respect for that. But God found no pleasure in Cain's offering because He had specified that it be a blood offering. And here comes Cain, and he gives a grain offering from his field. Well, it's just like what people do today. The Bible says, do this in your worship, do that in your worship. But people say, oh, we don't have to do all of that. We can just do it this way, or we can do it that way. God is no more pleased with people today that do whatever they want than He was with Cain when Cain brought forth that offering of grain when he specified blood. God put a mark upon Cain. Romans 15 and verse 4. Says, for whatso things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of scriptures might have hope. So what we read about Cain has plenty to do with us today. Whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. Why would we need to learn about Cain? Well, it's an example that God has set forth that if Cain was, He was not pleased with Cain for not worshiping in the way that he should, He's not going to be pleased with us today if we don't worship the way that we should. It's that simple. The important thing overlooked in this situation is that in Genesis 3, God had already announced His plan for sending His Son to die as a redeemer of the human race. It had already been talked about, and the blood of animal sacrifices, which men were required to offer throughout the Old Testament, pointed to faith that would eventually lead to the cross at Calvary. You know, all of those animals that were sacrificed and all the blood that was spilled was to remove the sin between that individual and let them stand in front of God. Not that it forgave it. It wasn't forgiven until the forgiving of blood of Christ was shed and it could be forgiven. But those blood sacrifices removed that sin and let those people be able to have a relationship with God. To God, animal sacrifice was a salvational issue. It led to today, to the sacrifice, the only sacrifice that forgave sins. It was an expression of faith in God's coming Savior and His death upon the cross. That's what it all led up to. That's why we use that as a stepping stone. We know that all of those things that God put into place led us and got us to where we are today. They all played in and worked in like pieces of a puzzle. And when all of those pieces came together, guess what it all boiled down to? The forgiving blood of Jesus Christ that God put into place from before time. Doing God's will does make a difference. Cain did not do it. He was punished for it. Whether or not we understand every why and every wherefore makes no difference. We don't have to understand everything. We just need to understand that we need to worship God and we need to do for God as God wills and instructs us to do, not the way that we want to do it ourselves. It does take great faith, though, to do things that He commands us when we can't see the reason or purpose. You know, there's a lot of things that we don't understand this side of heaven. There really are. But it takes a lot of faith to keep doing those and being faithful, not knowing the outcome. There are 6 biblical words used in the Bible that translate into English as worship. Throughout the whole Bible, there's 6 different words that they have used in different ways and different possibilities that translate to mean worship. Each casts just a little different light on the subject of worship. One means an act of homage and reverence. Another means an act of devotion. Another means the ability to bow down. Another means to sacrifice of oneself in humility. And one implies a pattern for religious service, and it's just as important as everything else. You know, the Bible, we have commands, we have examples, and we have patterns that are set forth for us to do and to obey. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. We see this throughout the entirety of the Bible. There is not one word in the Bible that has been translated for worship that means celebration or festivity or a ceremony or a ritual, because that's not what worship is all about. It's really not. But yet today, a lot of people think that, man, they can just have the best old time when it comes to worship. They can do whatever they please. They can just get up and run around and holler and do all sorts of things. But not one time does any of those words ever suggest anything to that effect. I want to look at some of the Bible scriptures where we have some of these words used and see what took place in the worship as these words were used, and it's worship to God. In Genesis 24, verse 26, we have a servant of Abraham who was to seek a wife for Isaac. And before his journey, the scripture says the man bowed down. And that's one of those words that was used and translated. And it means, for worship, means bowed down his head and spoke with the Lord. So he bowed his head when he worshiped God in an act of reverence to God. And on in verse 52, after Rebekah's brother had given consent for Rebekah to marry Isaac, the servant said he worshiped the Lord, bowing down himself to the earth. That same word translated there, bowing down, showing a reverence when you worship God. In Exodus 4 and 31, when Moses and Aaron told the elders of the children of Israel about God's plan to deliver them from bondage from Egypt, it says they bowed their heads in worship. There was another form of that word used there, but translated means again that they bowed their heads and thanked God. When King David took the people of Israel, or told the people of Israel that he had made preparations for building the temple in Jerusalem, and in 1 Chronicles 29 and 20, it tells us that they bowed down their heads and worshiped the Lord. You see, none of these words that are used means celebration or party or carrying on or doing any of these great things. It shows a true reference to God and how we're to be. Solomon built the temple. He built it according to God's plan. And after the dedication of the temple in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, it says they bowed their heads with their faces to the ground and they worshiped and praised the Lord. In Nehemiah, when Ezra the scribe was chosen to read from the book of the law of Moses, when he opened the book, it says all the people stood up. And in Nehemiah 8 and 6, it says we're told that they bowed their heads. And that's one of the other words that was translated. They stood up in reference and they bowed their heads. So all of these words that are translated for worship have to do it with treating God with the utmost respect, not running around crazily doing things, saying things, and acting a fool, but giving God the praise and the reverence that he so desires and deserves. When Job was told about the loss of his children, over in Job chapter 1, we're told that he fell down upon the ground and he worshiped God. He didn't dance around. He didn't do all. He fell down on the ground as an act of reverence, and he worshiped God. In all of these different areas where these different words are used, what have they told us? And these are not isolated events. There's many other scriptures that these words are used, that are translated, these five different words. All we have to do is open up our Bibles and read and study, see the examples, see the patterns that are taking place. We see what the Scripture tells us. That's what they have in common. What God tells us, what the Scriptures tell us. Always, when people are seen to worship God, it's an act of humbleness, it's an act of reverence, and an act of fear and bowing themselves before the Lord. People don't fear God today, not the way that they used to. They really don't. They do anything and everything they want to do without any fear of anything. They just lack that fear of God. Never, not even once in worship, is one of these words ever characterized by shouting or laughing or dancing or celebrating. Nothing. Not one thing. This activity will only frivolize the act of worship. It's a special thing. Only needed to be included what we need to include. And that's to pay respect to God and reverence to God and that fear to God. What we read in the Bible about worshiping God is a far cry from what we find in a lot of assemblies today. Psalms 2 and verse 11 says, "Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling." There's not a lot of trembling going on with people today. People are just doing anything and everything that they want to do. Worship to God is supposed to be an act of humility, an act of submission, and an act of obedience. But when you do whatever you want to do, you're leaving God out of the picture. You're leaving His desires out of the picture and what He wants, and you're substituting what you want. Psalms 99 and verse 5 says, "Exalt ye the Lord our God and worship at His footstool, for He is holy." When we put and worship God the way we want, we're not putting God, we're not at God's footstool worshiping Him. We're putting ourselves at our own footstool. We're worshiping the way we want, not the way that God wants. It's not the modern perception of worship to worship just the way that God wants you to. If you do and preach that and talk about that, you're not very well taken and you're not very well liked, because everybody wants to worship the way they want. They believe that, hey, we live in a country that we have freedom of religion, so we're just going to worship any way that we want. Well, freedom of religion doesn't say that you can worship any way you want. Freedom of religion just gives you the freedom so that you can worship the way that God wants you to. But people have misunderstood that, and they take it that, hey, we can just worship any old way that we want. Worshiping God with reverence and godly fear is very important. Why? Because there's none greater than God. That's why. He is the greatest that's ever been and ever will be. Look around. Our worship of Him in spirit and in truth affects every aspect of our lives, and it should. It should affect everything that we do, because we want to be and follow His examples and His teachings. It affects our morals. It affects our character. It affects our concerns for salvation and the souls of others. Our lack of reverence and genuine awe for God in our worship is at the very heart of so many social ills in the world today. The people have gotten away from what God demands and what God wants and what God likes, and they've just started doing what they want. Nearly all of the religious groups that call themselves Christians are concerned with what is being done in their worship assemblies, because a lot of it has gotten out of hand. Many of I've done a lot of reading on the internet about different denominations, and there's concern in just about everyone about where worship has gotten to today. But you know, there was a lot of concern at one time in the world about this Reformation movement, about how people had gotten away from God. It's back to that point again. There's a lot of concern about how people are worshiping God. There's a lot of wild and weird things that people call worship. There are a lot of patterns that are tearing apart churches and the things that people want to do and want to incorporate. Traditions of men are being held above the traditions and the commandments of God. And very little focus and attention is given on worshiping God in spirit and truth the way that we should. To be blunt and honest with what we read and see on TV and hear on the radio on religious worship today, it's easy to say that a lot of people are offering, as Cain did, strange fire, Nadab and Abihu. That always comes to mind. We know what happened to them when they offered strange fire. Over in Leviticus 10 and in verse 1, it says, "And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer, put fire therein, and put incense therein, and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not." Now, that ought to tell us something right there. If we didn't know the rest of the story, it says, "which he commanded them not." Anytime we do something or take it on ourselves to do something that God has not commanded, we're in uncharted territory with God. We're in no man's land. We're not there for approval. We're taking it on ourselves. Worship to God is so very, very important, and it must be done with reverence and with fear, with that godly fear. Hebrews 12 and verse 29 says, "For our God is a consuming fire." Can you understand why God wants to be worshiped the way He does? He certainly couldn't enjoy it and have any pride in everybody worshiping the way they want. Their standards, and He set those standards. We're supposed to worship Him in spirit and in truth and through the things and with the things that He has approved of. But you have people today that say, "That's not my God. You know, He's not going to be a consuming fire. He's not going to do anything to me. You know, after all, I worship God. I do all of these things in His name." Well, I just keep reminding myself about that scripture in Matthew that talks about many will say in that day, "Lord, Lord, have I not prophesied in Thy name? Have I not done all of these good things?" You know what that scripture says? "Depart from me, I never knew you." If we think we can do whatever we want and please God, we're mighty, mighty mistaken, because we can't. He's a jealous God. He has every right to be. We need to worship God the way He wants to be worshipped, not the way we want to worship. If you don't believe that, you need to study your Bibles. You need to read your Bibles. So we must show genuine humility, reverence, and submit to His will completely. I think you can begin to understand how important it is to worship God in the way that He wants to be worshipped. It's chaos because of mankind throwing in everything that everybody wants to do, and the point of worship and the way of worship that God wants gets lost somewhere along the way in all the confusion. And that's not what pleases God. Society is seeking answers to many questions. It's easy to understand that there's so many people that are seeking answers to so many problems. Why do young people some who are even raised up in the church and then go out into the world. Why are these people taking guns and killing people? Why are children that are raised up even in the church killing people? How can it possibly be that in a nation where 92% of the people believe that they are Christians, that people have such low morals and such high crime rates? It's staggering at the crime rate in this country, and yet 96% of the people claim to be Christians. It leaves us to wonder that with all the churches and all the Bible warnings and all the feel-good worship services, are we really offering God what He wants in our worship? I believe we are, and I hope we are and continue to do that, but I don't believe everyone is. You know, there's so many people in the world today that are ready just to give only what they want, and that's all. And they expect God to take the crumbs that they want to throw God's way. They're just along for the ride, just along for the show, so to speak. Sometimes I think a lot of people feel that and look to God that He's sort of like a machine, that He's an automatic grace dispenser. If you say the word God or you do something good and claim it for God, then boy, you're going to get that grace thrown your way. But it's not so. God will hold us accountable for our words. He'll hold us accountable for our deeds. He'll hold us accountable for things that we should have done that we haven't done. I wonder what God thinks as He looks down and sees all the things that are going on today. Do you think He thinks, boy, I wish these people would get back to the basics. I wish these people would get back to the Bible. I wish these people would just do what I want them to do. I think He does. I think and that's all He's wanted from beginning of time. When people have strayed, He's always just wanted them to repent, always wanted them to get back to where they needed to be. And I think as He looks down on this world today, He just thinks, I wish they would get back to where they need to be. You know, there's many people that need to get back where they need to be. We have to realize that our worship to God is so important. It must be done God's way, not ours. It must be done in spirit and truth. We must study His Word to know how we're to do it and how we're to live. It's so important. If we get that wrong, we can get so many things else wrong. If we can read the Bible and study the Bible and think that we can just worship God in any way, what else in our life is going to be amok? Can it be issues that would really concern our salvation and our eternity? Absolutely. I hope everyone here tonight is a Christian. But if there's one here tonight that has not obeyed the gospel, just as God desires mankind to worship Him in specific ways, He requires people to come to Him in specific ways and obey the gospel in obedience in particular ways. We're to hear the Word of God. We're to believe it. We're to be repentful, confess Christ as the Son of God, and be baptized for the remission of sins, the forgiveness of sin. You know, there's people that teach all around the world baptism's not necessary, yet the Bible says time and time again it's necessary. Who do you believe? Believe God. Believe and obey God and do things God's way. You'll come out far better when you show God the reverence and the respect that He deserves and desires, and do things His way rather than doing it your way or someone else's way. If you're here tonight and you're not a Christian, we'd certainly hope and pray that you'd want to obey the gospel. If maybe you've fallen away, we'd hope and pray that you'd want to get back on the right road. If we can help you in any way tonight to get to God's way, we're certainly here to help you. We're going to stand and sing this song of encouragement. And please, if you have a need, respond if you have it. All to Jesus.